Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. If you could please take your seats because the event will begin in 5 minutes' time. Thank you. Announcing the arrival of the Minister of Higher Education, Malaysia. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, please rise for Negaraku, the Malaysian National Anthem. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, please rise for Negaraku, the Malaysian National Anthem. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Yang Berhormat Dato Seri Idris Jusoh, Minister of Higher Education, Malaysia, Professor Dr. Asha Kanwar, President and CEO, Commonwealth of Learning, OCOL, Yang Berbahagia Professor Dato Dr. Mansur Fazil, President, Vice Chancellor, Open University Malaysia, Honourable Ministers, Excellencies, Foreign Dignitaries, Distinguished Guests, Ladies and Gentlemen. Assalamualaikum and good morning. Welcome to the opening ceremony of the 8th Pan-Commonwealth Forum, or PCF8. OUM and Commonwealth of Learning warmly welcomes all of you from across the globe to this beautiful country of ours, Malaysia.
We are honoured to be given the privilege to host this auspicious conference. Held triennially, this conference is hoped to be the bridge for the Commonwealth community to exchange knowledge and experiences, identify important trends, and explore applications of open and distance learning in widening access, bridging digital divide, and advancing the social and economic development of communities and countries. It brings together prominent keynote speakers, scholars, researchers, and practitioners in the area of open, online, and flexible learning. We are grateful that everyone has made it here safely. Today, we have almost 400 participants from 55 countries assembled to take part in the conference. The theme for this conference is Open, Online, and Flexible Learning, the Key to Sustainable Development, in line with Commonwealth of Learning's focus in empowering and strengthening institutions in developing Commonwealth countries that are striving to provide affordable education to larger numbers of their citizens. Let us begin this momentous event with a doa recitation. We would like to invite Associate Professor Dr. Muhammad Yusof Ahmad, Dean of Faculty of Applied Social Sciences, to lead the doa.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and good morning. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah alladhi 'allama bil qalam. علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنام ومصباح الظلام سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه ما دامت الليالي والأيام segala puji-puji dan kesyukuran kita rafakkan kehadrat Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala yang menciptakan sekalian alam. Salawat dan salam kita anjurkan kepada junjungan besar Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, pengulu sekalian nabi dan penyudah sekalian rasul yang menjadi rahmat bagi sekalian alam. Ya Allah, ya Syakur, ya Alim. Kami memanjatkan setinggi-tinggi kesyukuran kehadiratmu, ya Allah. Bahawa dengan taufik dan hidayahmu, kami dapat menganjurkan seminar PCF8 pada hari ini di tempat yang indah ini. Ya Allah, permudahkanlah segala urusan kami di seminar ini. Berilah kemudahan kepada pihak penganjur dan pentadbir untuk menguruskan perjalanan seminar ini dengan jayanya. Demikian juga, permudahkan peserta-peserta untuk mengikuti seminar ini dengan mengambil bahagian di dalam perbincangan dengan penuh ceria dan sejahtera. Jadikan seminar ini sebagai satu wadah bagi kami yang menimba ilmu untuk dimanfaatkan dalam pentadbiran serta pengajaran dan pembelajaran yang berasaskan kepada pembelajaran secara online dan pembelajaran sepanjang hayat. Ya Allah, jadikan seminar ini suatu yang bermanfaat kepada kami dan institusi kami serta membuahkan hasil yang berguna kepada semua pihak sama ada peserta, penganjur dan masyarakat amnya. Amin. Ya Rabbal Alamin. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanah wa qina azaban nar. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alamin. Thank you. Assalamualaikum.
Thank you. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, it is our great pleasure to invite the President and Vice-Chancellor of Open University Malaysia, Yang Berbahagia Professor Datuk Dr. Mansor Fazil, to deliver his welcoming remarks.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and good morning to all. Yang berhormat Dato Seri Idris Jusoh, Minister of Higher Education Malaysia, Honorable Ministers of Education from Botswana, Ghana, Nigeria, Seychelles and Swaziland, Excellencies, Professor Dr. Asha Kanwar, President and CEO, Commonwealth of Learning, Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Lee Lam Tai, Chairman Board of Directors of Open University Malaysia, Yang Berbahagia Profesor Datuk Dr. Ansari Ahmad, Vice-Chancellor of Asia E-University, Profesor Datuk Ho Sin Chai, Vice-Chancellor of Wawasan Open University, members of the Board of Open University Malaysia, esteemed keynote speakers, delegates and participants, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Let me begin by offering a warm welcome to all delegates and participants to the opening ceremony of the 8th Pan-Commonwealth Forum on Open Learning. We are delighted to host you in Kuala Lumpur for this special event. As open and distant learning practitioners, stakeholders, research communities, academic and ordinary citizens from all across the globe, your presence here today represents the diversity that is central to the spirit of the Commonwealth. Thank you for taking part in PCFA. I'm pleased to share that we have with us a very special guest of honor this morning. He has taken his time off his busy schedule as Malaysia's Minister of Higher Education to officiate the launch of PCF8. Yang Berhormat Datuk Seri Idris Jusoh, allow me to represent my fellow colleague from Open University Malaysia, the Commonwealth of Learning, and all our speakers, guests and delegates in thanking you for gracing this opening ceremony. We are most honored that you have joined us to officially open this prestigious event. Ladies and gentlemen, the success of PCF8 in the next several days will depend not only on the various efforts by COAL and OUM as the forum co-host, but also on the active participation by all delegates. Similar to previous editions of the forum, PCF8 will include a very comprehensive 4-day schedule that will include, among others, the ASA break lecture, 1 plenary session, 4 keynote addresses, several pre-conference workshops and online forum, 10 parallel sessions, 3 country showcases, as well as the market exchange. I hope that this program will provide enlightening opportunities for discussion, sharing and exchange among all delegates and participants. Open, online and flexible learning is undeniably an essential element in higher education. Over the last several decades, we have witnessed how this approach, through the effort of open universities globally, has widened access to learning opportunities to a great number of people, regardless of creed, age, background, or location. I believe it is with the same spirit that ODL has also made its mark in the broader sphere of lifelong learning. Today, with the various technologies and flexible teaching and learning arrangement, ODL make it possible for virtually anyone to partake in any form of learning, whether formal academic education, non-formal or informal courses and program, and as the means for any personal or professional end. With a theme of open, online and flexible learning, the key to sustainable development, PCF8 hope to explore the various facets of ODL approach in encouraging sustainability across all human initiatives. It is both exciting and humbling that such an extraordinary group of experts have convened here to deliberate on the salient theme that will be discussed throughout this forum. I hope that PCF8 can provide a valuable platform to bring fruition our aspiration regarding sustainable development through educational enterprises. This in turn can hopefully lead to far-reaching benefit for everyone in the entire Commonwealth community. Ladies and gentlemen, OUM is proud to co-host with COAL in organizing PCF8. As an institution with a long-standing relationship with COAL, over the years, we have strived to support COAL's various initiatives in many ways. In co-hosting PCF8, we hope to demonstrate our continuous support of COAL and its noble agenda. We also hope that it will further cement our collective commitment to the global ODL cause. As the first ODL institution in Malaysia, OUM has been privileged with numerous opportunities to share our experiences and collaborate with other open universities around the world. We have also dedicated our energy to the organizing of various national and international conferences over the past decade. PCF8 is perhaps the pinnacle of our effort as host to such conferences, and we hope to represent our nation in the best possible way. As a representative of the organizing committees, I would like to assure all delegates and participants that we will do our level best to ensure the smooth running of the program over these 4 days. In turn, I look forward to everyone's active participation throughout the activities that have been planned. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you once again for the support you have shown to OUM, COAL and PCFA. Welcome to Kuala Lumpur, and I wish everyone fruitful deliberation and a pleasant stay in Malaysia. Have a good day. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you. Now, we would like to invite the President and CEO of COAL, Prof. Asha Kanwa, to share a few words.
Oh, Honourable Minister Dr. Idris Jusoh, guest ministers, Dr. Linda Sissons, Professor Dr. Manzoor Fazil, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the 8th Pan-Commonwealth Forum. I am delighted that the chair of our Board of Governors, Dr. Linda Sissons, and our distinguished board members, Ambassador Miriam Kattagam and Mr. Martin Bean, whom you heard earlier this morning, are with us today. Two of the former presidents of COL, Tan Sri Emeritus Professor Raj Dhanarajan and Sir John Daniel, made a special effort to be present. In addition, ministers of education from 5 Commonwealth countries, Botswana, Ghana, Nigeria, Swaziland, and the Seychelles, have traveled long distances to grace the occasion. The Executive Director of UN Women, herself an eminent educationist, will enrich the deliberations with her keynote. Honourable Minister, these forums are organised with local partners, and I must express my sincere thanks to our gracious hosts and partner, the Open University of Malaysia. Professor Dr. Manzoor Fazil has taken personal interest in planning this PCF, and his team, particularly the organizing committee headed by Professor Ramli Behroom, who is also a very talented singer, have devoted considerable time and energy to making this a particularly pleasant and rewarding collaboration. The PCFs are held in different parts of the Commonwealth. The first was held in neighboring Brunei, followed by those in South Africa, New Zealand, Jamaica, UK, India, and Nigeria. After traveling around the Commonwealth, PCF has returned to Malaysia, truly Asia. Honorable Minister, we are very grateful for the continuing support provided by your government. We also appreciate our partnership with several institutions in Malaysia. I was here earlier this year when vice chancellors and senior administrators from 19 countries came to Putrajaya to deliberate on how to enhance the quality and leadership in higher education institutions around the Commonwealth. Under your leadership, Honorable Minister, higher education in Malaysia is undergoing several transformations. Noteworthy among these are the accreditation of prior experiential learning and assigning credits to MOOCs. These are not only major steps in mainstreaming open distance and flexible learning, but are also important models for other countries to learn from. As more governments around the Commonwealth review their policies and action plans in preparation for achieving the Sustainable Development Goal 4, which aspires to provide equitable access to quality education and lifelong learning for all by 2030, open distance and flexible learning is increasingly becoming a crucial option that can help address issues of access, quality, costs, and equity. Malaysia has a long tradition of leadership in open and distance learning. It has much to share with the rest of the world. The participants representing 55 countries bring their own unique experiences and will take away many new ones from this confluence of ideas around the main theme of this forum, open, online, and flexible learning, the key to sustainable development. One key outcome of this forum, Honorable Minister, will be the Kuala Lumpur Declaration. Let me thank our hosts, the Ministry of Higher Education, our partners, OUM, and all the sponsors, international and local, who have contributed generously to making this event possible. Let me also thank the growing PCF community for their presence and participation. I hope your time here will be both productive and memorable, and that you will leave more empowered after the exciting deliberations and return home eager to transform your environments. We are all partners in creating a world where, as the poet Tagore said, and I quote, "The mind is without fear and the head is held high, where knowledge is free, where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection, unquote. Let all of us be a part of ushering in that heaven of freedom and enlightenment. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. Ashraf. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, our highlight for today. To deliver the opening speech of the conference, may we invite the guest of honour, Minister of Higher Education Malaysia, Yang Berhormat Dato Seri Idris Jusoh.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum and very good morning to all of you. Honorable ministers, I'm glad to see 5 or 6 ministers together with you this morning from Botswana, Ghana, Nigeria, Seychelles, Switzerland. Big hands to all my friend ministers who are here. Excellencies, Prof. Dr. Asha Kanwar, President and CEO of CALL. Also, thank you, Professor, for choosing Malaysia. Also, big hand to Professor Asha. We have a talk this morning that I think that it will be more fruitful in Malaysian participation in CALL, perhaps. Professor Dr. Mansur Fazil, the President, Vice Chancellor of OUM. So big hands to him. There's a new rule this morning, okay? I'm telling you that I'm talking about open, online, flexible education. So the keyword is flexible, open. So sit back and relax. And no seat belts are required, and enjoy yourself. You look so stiff this morning. You want to be look so formal. Probably it's not here where we want to be more flexible, where education has to be more enjoyable and more fun. I'm so glad to see here my two good friends here, Tan Sri Lee Lam Tai. Also, big hands to Tan Sri Lee Lam Tai. And my former teacher, my former lecturer, Tan Sri Koh Soo Koon. Also, big hands to Koh Soo Koon. Tan Sri Koh Soo Koon was my former lecturer. A good one. No, there's some lousy lecturers, but he's a good one. It gives me a great pleasure, actually, to address this gathering of delegates and participants from 48th Pan-Commonwealth Forum on Open Learning, as being said, PCF8. Honored to be among this great education fraternity or educational practitioners and stakeholders from Commonwealth nations across the globe. To our international guests, let me bid you a warm welcome to Malaysia by using the word Selamat Datang. It means welcome. Welcome to Malaysia. Or some people say Selamat Datang. Whatever it is. And again, congratulations to Commonwealth of Learning, COL, and Open University Malaysia for bringing together diverse group of policymakers, experts, and leaders in open, online, and flexible learning to Kuala Lumpur. For what I understand, this is a triennial event, happen every 3 years, some every 2 years. Perhaps some countries get too excited, they cannot wait for 3 years. And we seven other countries who have been hosting, a privilege of hosting this event, this forum. Basically Brunei, South Africa, New Zealand, Jamaica, United Kingdom, India, and the previous one was Nigeria in 2013. This year, we play host, it's our turn, through OUM's initiative. I was informed that as the co-hosting institution, OUM has been working closely with COAL for more than a year to ensure the success of this event. Congratulations to OUM. And the theme, open, online, and flexible learning. The key to sustainable development is very, very, very relevant. The three varies over there. Where globalization was the buzzword two decades ago, nowadays people, everybody seems to be talking about sustainable development. If you go around, you don't see a word of sustainable development, you are not in trend nowadays. You have to go around. Last two decades, you go around, you have to see the word globalization. Now you go around, you have to see sustainable development, and you are in trend. So of course, that's what is happening. COAL is in trend. So don't have to worry about it. We are on the right track. Sustainable development is closely associated with economic growth, social inclusion, and environmental protection. These three core elements represent a global outlook of many grave issues like climate change, financial crisis, poverty, gender disparity, socio-economic inequalities, depletion of fossil fuels, which is not happening as much because the price of oil has gone down. Now it's touching again $50 a barrel, and increasing endangerment to our flora and fauna. These issues may all be linked to an unfortunate origin. Development that prioritizes current demands over future consequences. Probably demand that is based on greed rather than what is needed. An example is climate change, which is mainly due to human activities such as rapid industrial development. Everybody is going for GDP and GNI. Uncontrolled emissions of greenhouse gases, deforestation and land use. For example, what do climate change to all other global issues signify for our future generation? Will they enjoy the same bounties on this earth as we do right now? Or will they be preoccupied with finding solutions to solve the problems that we have created? Is there still time for us to reverse? Can we go backwards? Or at the very least, the effects of all this that has been transpired. This leads to United Nations to come up with 17 Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, for the period of 2016 and 2030. These goals seek to end poverty, protect the planet, and ensure prosperity to all. Sounds very good. Prosperity to all. Malaysia supports the Millennium Development Goals. But again, crucial to all this global initiative is emphasis on one important factor, which is education, which is fundamental element behind the social economic endeavor, be it for ensuring prudent consumption, managing disasters, and creating employment opportunities. I would like to say that this open, online and flexible learning is very close to my heart. I said personally, because in my inaugural speech in my ministry at the beginning of the year, the theme was flexible education. I believe in it. I was telling the whole Malaysians, I was telling the whole Malaysian universities to believe and to adopt flexible education. Historically, you see, education was very formal. Started probably in churches, mosques, in palaces. People can afford to be educated, and it started in a small way. Hence, we understand of education. We started to build universities 1,000 years ago to educate more and more people in various territories and countries. The birth of Oxford, the birth of Cambridge, and the birth of Harvard, which is also in Cambridge. I was a bit confused when I was in Harvard. They said Harvard is in Cambridge, so I was wondering. I know it was in Boston. And in the Islamic world, you can see the birth of Qarauin University in Fez, Morocco, and led again to Tunisia in Azahar in Egypt. In Malaysia, we have universities only over 100 years ago. 160 years ago, which is University of Malaya. And all the other universities in Malaysia, besides University of Malaya, are less than 50 years old. We are very, very young. What more? OUM. OUM is a baby. I mean, not a baby in the real sense. You know, yeah. They are old babies. They are only 16 years old. And we have Wawasan, which is kind of 11 years old probably. So, in Malaysia, education is very, very young compared to the others that we have in the world. As the demand grew, more people need to be educated. We built schools throughout the country. We need more teachers to teach in schools. Distant learning was created. Older people can go to universities. I remember when I was in USM, University Science Malaysia, with my lecturer here, we were young at a particular time. We see older people in universities. That's the impact of distant learning. They come once in a while, every 3 months kind of thing, where lecture notes are being posted to them, they're referring to the books. But now, time has changed. Technology has changed. The mails before, the post offices before, now everything is online. You can put it online the instant you want it to be shown. The cloud has ruled the world. Everything is in the cloud. Information that we need is in the cloud. Your uncle Google is very friendly now. Probably the best uncle that you can have. You have many uncles, of course, Uncle Googles. Some are good uncles, tell you the right thing. Some bad uncles tell you all the wrong things you need not know. In fact, as I'm saying, that technology has changed the world in many ways. And not only changing the world, and changing the world at a faster rate. The Moore's Law says it changes double every 2 years. And the price decreases by half, also every 2 years. We're having electric cars running around. And soon we're going to have autonomous driverless car. We have loans being approved within 3 minutes. Business loan that used to take 3 months to approve can be approved within 3 minutes. money disbursed within a minute with no human interface. This is what Jack Ma called 310 loan system with the help of business analytics. 3 minutes, I want to repeat myself unless you get confused. It's 3 minutes for processing. 3 minutes, not days or hours. 3 minutes for processing. 1 minute for disbursement and zero human interface. The so-called 310 loan system. It has changed the way we do business in the world. Not only that, technology changes has changed the legal framework. Who are you going to sue in an accident with a driverless car? You want to sue the car? Or you want to sue Tesla or whatever, the maker of the car? The political scenario has changed. The Arab Spring, the Brexit, and lastly, the new president of America. Things are changing. And things are changing very fast. They're not on Commonwealth, so they're not here. Okay, never mind. Technology has changed the way we live. Technology has changed the way we work and the way we play. So is education. So education needs to be more flexible. That's the reason we say that we need to have flexible education. In my ministry, the Ministry of Higher Education in Malaysia, we talk how we redesign the education system. How we redesign. We have to redesign our education system. In the beginning of the year, I was saying flexible education. Towards the end of the year, we have to see how we redesign the education system to adapt to the current needs of the world. Education needs to be lifelong. You have to keep on learning because the apps in your phones keep on changing. Not only do you need to change the phones every 1 year to keep up with the new capacity of the phone, new camera of the phone, you want to be the latest. I keep on changing my phone from Samsung to iPhone, again to Samsung, so that I don't get comfortable. Nothing wrong with iPhone, nothing wrong with Samsung, but not 7. So that I won't be comfortable. I won't be complacent with just too used to being iPhone or too used to be Samsung, because we can't be comfortable anymore. Of course, I curse myself in the first month after the changes, because they're not the same. And I said, in this fast changing world, learning is lifelong. No more. I'm still at the age of 61 and I'm still learning. Of course, not because I'm still learning, because I believe that life starts at 60. And 60 is a new 40. So it consoles those who are 60 years old. And I have a friend of mine who's going to be 70. And I'm telling him, when he's 70, end of this year, he's only 10. Because life starts at 60. Education is going to be non-linear. There's got to be open entry, open exit. It's got to be modular and stackable. I'm saying this because you have to be allowed to adapt to your personal needs. Education has to be adapted to your personal needs, the needs of you and your family. Need time for you to contemplate after working for probably 10 years. Probably you need to contemplate whether you're doing the right thing or not. You should be given a gap year in your working life also and be able to go in and out of universities. I call it a stackable, a modular, and stackable. I'm saying this, I'm doing it in Malaysia at the moment. Our technical vocational education is adjusting as such that working people can come in at any time they want and go out at any time they want. Of course, you have to do it within one semester. If you go out in before you get your credit, you're not going to get anywhere. You won't get the credits. Education is getting to be more authentic. There's greater choice for you. The pedagogy has changed. We call it heotagogy nowadays, where you can determine what you want to learn, rather than you're being told by your lecturer what to learn, what to read, what to do, when to come, when to go, how to get A's, how to get B's. If you follow the instruction of your lecturers, you get A's. So those people who get A's are those who follow the instruction or the needs of your lecturer. Who can be obsolete? Because they teach what they learned 10 years ago, when things are changing so fast. I'm sorry to say this. I'm saying this to some of my VCs here, vice chancellors here, some of my lecturers here. And I keep on saying that. Education has to be work-based nowadays. I said, be flexible and need to redesign education where experiential learning is needed. That's why in Malaysia, as being said, that we are giving credits to experiential learning, as being said by Prof. Asha just now. Thank you. You've been studying Malaysian education system. Meaning that if you need to go for your master's, if you already have a degree, or even if you're going for your degree, your experiential learning, your work experience will be given credits for what you have done. We have started this in Malaysia under the program of APEL. Probably some of my classmates, some of my ministry people can enlighten you further on this. And we want to deliver graduates who are holistic, entrepreneurial, and balanced. That's the first thrust of our blueprint. We need to increase collaboration among universities, not only in the country, but also from other countries. And we are doing multidisciplinary. We are introducing 2 degrees, double degree, or even triple degree. We have started with a double degree, but we have not started with a triple degree. God willing, it's going to come very soon. And I said, besides recognizing MOOCs or online programs as a country initiative, the whole country, well, if you go to US, you can see that MIT, Harvard have your own MOOCs program. But in Malaysia, it's a country initiative. It's being recognized by our qualification agency. MOOCs is a national initiative in Malaysia. We have introduced a so-called integrated CGPA, which is beyond CGPA. Normally, you'll be evaluated on your academic successes, and all the others are being neglected. It's being said this morning, how do you measure the entrepreneurial spirit of a student? How do you measure his communication skill? How do you measure his social values? How do you measure his practical skills? There are 8 domains in the integrated CGPA, which I said is beyond CGPA, which we have started in September last year. In 5 universities, 5 faculties now, is all in our 20 public universities, God willing. Not enough, as I said, sit back and relax. As I said, we believe in flexible learning. That's why we introduce a so-called work-based curriculum, which we call 2U2I. I should have slides with me, but probably you can pass to you the books that how we do it. 2U2I meaning that you spend 2 years in universities and 2 years in the industry and still get a degree for it. We started this Last year, with 5 universities and 5 programs. This year, we have 7 universities and 17 programs doing it. We do invite all the big CEOs of big companies, CEOs from Shell in Malaysia, from Motorola, from Novartis, from Samsung, from Huawei, because we cannot invite Samsung without inviting Huawei. No? They will curse me for doing that. Of course, Malaysian companies, we have Khazana, we have our bank, Maybank, CIMB Bank, and Asia. These CEOs come to universities and they teach. Not only they teach, they spend 30 hours a year in the universities, networking with the lecturers, and look at our curriculum. This is what I say as flexible learning, and I say redesigning learning in Malaysia. And very soon, September next year, I've launched a program where I call it a jukebox concept. You know what jukebox is? Some of you, the old one probably, not the younger ones. I remember when I was small, I used to, while waiting for the bus, there was a big jukebox in the bus station where you could choose, and you understand? Oh, you understand, okay. You could choose the song that you want to sing. You pay 10 cents, you can choose a song you want to sing, you want to hear. A selection of songs that you have could be the Beatles, the ABBA, or Hindustani songs, which we love here. You put 10 cents, you can get the song that you want. Any. And of course, as a student at that particular time, I don't have that many 10 cents. Because 20 cents, 30 cents, a lot of money to me, particular time. So you're waiting there for others to pick up the song that you want to hear. You're waiting there. What I'm saying is that jukebox allow you to pick and choose. And we are collaborating with Tsukuba University in Japan, California University, National University of Taiwan, Bedok of France, and also Sao Paulo of Brazil to come up with the so-called jukebox program, which also need online flexible education in practice. Again, you can see, welcome to the interesting journey in flexible education. And now, education is more flexible. Changes in technology and innovation has made it more flexible. There's going to be greater access, greater efficiencies, and greater quality, whereby open, online, flexible education is the key to sustainable development. Now, it gives me great pleasure to officially declare open the 8th Pan-Commonwealth Forum on Open Learning. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.
May we invite Yang Berbahagia, Professor Dato Wanso and Prof. Asha to accompany Yang Berhormat Dato Sri. To launch our conference, may we invite Yang Berhormat Dato Sri to hit the rebana 8 times. We'll count together, Yang Berhormat. Again. All right, we'll start now. One.
One.
Two.
Two.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Three. Four. Five. Six. Seven. Eight. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we now invite Prof. Asha to present a collection of publications from both KOL and OUM as a token of appreciation to Yang Berhormat Dato Seri. Of this year's conference. Thank you again, Yang Berhormat Dato Seri. Ladies and gentlemen, for your information, the instrument Dato Seri beat on to launch the conference is known as the Rebana, a traditional Malay musical instrument. Historically, the instrument was used by early Muslim preachers to gain attention and to integrate music into their Muslim missionary work. Today, the Rebana is used for special occasions such as our launch today.
Earlier on, you heard Dato Sri's arrival heralded by a percussion band. Now, the percussion instrument is native to this region and is called the kompang. The instruments are almost always played in a group and is usually played to welcome guests of honour. And the ensemble of musicians you see in front here performing for us today is from Aswara, or the National Arts, Culture and Heritage Academy. These young men are dressed in traditional Malay warrior garb. Can we have a round of applause for our talented ensemble? Thank you, Aswara.
Thank you. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Malaysia may be a small country compared to many of your fine nations represented in this conference, but we are blessed with a land abundant with rainforests and natural wonders. However, these remote areas are not excluded from nation-building efforts, and key to this effort is the development of the teachers in this area. To share more about Malaysian teachers in remote areas, please help us welcome Yang Berbahagia Associate Professor Hazidi Abdul Hamid.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh, and a good morning to everyone. Yang Berhormat Dato Seri Idris Jusoh, Minister of Higher Education Malaysia. Honorable Ministers of Education, Your Excellencies, Professor Asha Kanwa, President and CEO of Commonwealth Learning, Professor Dato Dr. Mansur Fadil, President of OUM, esteemed keynote speakers, delegates, participants, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for being here. I will introduce you to, before we start, I will introduce you to one Malay word, and the word is pedalaman. You will hear this word often in this talk. Pedalaman means interiors. This referring to the interiors of the Malaysian Peninsula and the Isle of Borneo.
Pedalaman is the Malay word for the interiors. It refers to the interiors of the peninsula and Borneo that remains relatively untouched by rapid modernization. Cikgu Azhar bin Abdul Aziz is an OUM student and he teaches in the pedalaman. Cikgu Azhar and his family live in Bukit Mat Daling, Pahang. Cikgu Azhar's trip to Kuala Lipis starts early on Friday morning. The journey involves taking an earth road when the river is low. He takes a car from the Kuala Tahan jetty to Kuala Lipis. When he arrives early, he has to stay at a hotel for a night. Saturday morning, and it's time for classes. Cikgu Azhar is just one of many teachers of the Malaysian pedalaman who pursue their degrees with OUM. Determined individuals who sacrifice their time and effort in the pursuit of knowledge and their desire to become better teachers.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Malaysia. We have currently a population of 29.72 million people with a density of 92.7 people per square mile and a literacy rate of 94.71% above the age of 15. At the moment, we have 7,769 primary schools, 2,404 secondary schools, totaling 10,173 schools. But schools are being built all the time, so we hope to have more soon. As for teachers, these are, if you notice, those are the pedalaman schools. Pedalaman, we have primary schools totaling 832, which is about 8% of the schools. Students, we have primary school, about a bit more than 2 million primary school students. Secondary school, also a bit more than 2 million, totaling 4,873,928 students. As for teachers, we have primary school teachers, 239,000. Secondary school teachers, 181,000. A totaling 431,000 teachers. The Ministry of Education aspires to give, to provide quality education for the students of Malaysia. And they entrust the Teacher Education Division with the responsibility
for our professional development of the teachers. So the BPG plans and executes policies and plans to upgrade the teachers' academic qualifications. So the idea is, if we can have quality teachers, they will provide quality education. So why OUM? First, it's because we have a unique learning mode. We use blended pedagogy, and the students are able to gain their education without leaving the classroom. So if you take tens of thousands of teachers outside the classroom at once, the system would collapse. So this way, we can provide them with the education that they need and still be active teachers. We also have the geographical advantage because OUM has learning centers throughout the country. And in the case of the teachers, we develop the curriculum with the BPG to provide them with the latest curriculum. And we are, at the moment, the leader in Malaysia. We have always been, I think, leader of online learning. So our collaboration took several phases. In phase one, the Bachelor of Education, which started in 2002 and ended 2006, totaling 17,532 enrollment and 14,473 graduates. In phase two, we had the BTPE and the BTPS programs, and this is also where we started the pedalaman program, which is from 2006 and 2010. So the pedalaman teachers totaled at that time 3,517 graduates in total. So in the third phase, this is the BTPE. From 2011 to 2016, we have 9,297 graduates from 14,446. The reason why the number is quite significant, quite a bit less, is because quite a few of those teachers are still in the system, waiting to graduate perhaps next year or the year after. So the pedalaman teachers are divided into three categories: P1, P2, and P3. The basis of pedalaman categories are transport, how difficult it is to get to these places, how risky it is to get to those places, the water source, water supply at those places, the electricity supply, residential facilities, sanitation facilities, telecommunication facilities, health and security services, and public facilities including banks, postal service, and fuel availability. And these teachers, on top of their pay, they're given an allowance. So if you're at Pedalaman 1, you get 500 ringgit a month. If you're at Pedalaman 2, you get 1,000 ringgit a month. If you're at P3, you get 1,500 ringgit a month. So what is it like to go to P1? You would need one of these. And the road can sometimes be less than desirable. To go to P2, you might need to ride a boat. And to go to P3, you sometimes have to walk or traverse rivers, as you saw earlier. So here, this is an opportunity for MOE to be as caring employer to. They provide the equal opportunity for pedalaman teachers to continue their education. So here, OUM, as a learning provider, our job here was we developed a unique learning mode for the pedalaman known as TUPE, tupe we call it sometimes. In Malay, it stands for Tutorial Ulang Kaji Peperiksaan. In English, it's Tutorial Revisions and Examination. Tupe program is conducted during the school holidays three times a year when they go to the centers. Duration of the two-day session depends on the duration of school, of the school holidays. The number of courses also depends on the sessions, and the learning material is provided one semester earlier, where they take the modules and what the other learning materials that they need. They will take it with them back to their teaching stations, and they do their studying on their own. So we try to make our assignments and as experientially based as possible, which means if they need to run studies for their assignment, they can run it with their students or in their locality. So they have intensive face-to-face tutorial for each course when they go into their two-day sessions. They do their revisions and they face their final exam, and after that, they collect the studies for the next semester. So the real life of experience of these teachers, these pictures, coming pictures, are taken or given to us by students themselves. This one was taken by a student in Cebu, which he records his trip to the center. This is them teaching. The person taking the, if you notice, there's a man in a yellow cap. That's the person who gave us the pictures. Okay, and they had to cross rivers and go through muddy roads. These are logging roads. So a success story. First intake was in September 2007 of 184 teachers. Total enrollment was 939 and graduated 761. These are the pedalaman. So this is a picture of a trip to Pansiangan, Salinatan, Sabah. So our OUM officials, our staff went to visit these teachers. You will see that they had to take the boat, they go up the jetty. That is our registrar, by the way, the lady in front. The accommodations are on the school grounds, those little huts, and the picture on this, that is the schoolhouse where all the teaching activities are run. So they had an evening with the teachers and parents and exchanged gifts. So what does that mean to the teacher? I'll let the teacher speak for himself.
Saya rasa dengan benda belajar ini ialah pentinglah untuk saya untuk mendidik anak bangsa saya, terutama dia kepada murid-murid orang asli lah. Okay, dengan ilmu yang ditawarkan untuk saya mengalami pelajaran ini ialah saya dapat aplikasikan ilmu saya ini kepada anak didik saya, terutamanya kepada murid-murid saya yang pedalaman itu orang-orang asli. Semasa saya menerima tawaran daripada kementerian dan juga OUM untuk melanjut ke pelajaran kepada SMP, pertama saya ragu-ragu juga tentang program ini. Bolehkah saya belajar lagi sebab saya berada pedalaman? Tapi apabila saya dah masuk dan dapat tawaran dan saya belajar di OUM campus Tuku Abang Hamzah, Kuala Lipis, saya tengok program ini amat penting, amat bagus, amat menarik dan amat kondusif untuk guru-guru yang berada di pedalaman. Kerana belajarnya ialah waktu cuti sekolah, maka ruang dan peluang untuk cikgu pergi ke sana itu untuk belajar itu lebih senang lah, lebih baik lah saya untuk belajar dan untuk menjalankan tugasan yang diberikan oleh OUM. Maka bertepatan lah dengan apa yang diberikan oleh OUM masa tu belajar untuk sama SMP ini di waktu cuti persekolahan, maka saya tidak terkejar-kejar dan program SMP amat baguslah bagi saya kerana boleh membantu saya, menolong saya kerana tidak ada tekanan. Saya pergi belajar dan saya boleh menjalankan tugasan dan saya exam, dan balik tu saya dah tumpu kepada mengajar di sekolah.
Cikgu Barzuki, the person who you just heard, graduated a couple of years ago, and he has since been promoted. I think he's a Timbalan Guru Kanan now. No, it's not here. He's in Kelantan though. And he doesn't want to give his picture. He's a bit self-conscious. So with that, I will thank the Ministry of Education, the Teachers Education Division, and the Pedalaman teachers for their contribution to this talk. And thank you. Yeah. Do you have any questions?
Thank you, Prof. Hazidi. Ladies and gentlemen, for more information on all of our country showcases, if you have questions for Prof. Hazidi, there's actually a country showcase booth at the Market Exchange Exhibition Hall. There are two more country showcases after this, in our subsequent sessions.
Okay. So, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, that marks the end of the opening ceremony. We would like to express our heartfelt gratitude to Yang Berhormat Datuk Seri for launching our conference. Thank you, Datuk Seri.
May we now invite honourable ministers and high commissioners to be on the stage for a group photo with Yang Berhormat Datuk Seri Idris Jusoh.